Good afternoon, everyone. This is Mark Romali here with the Hurricane Outlook and Discussion for September 17th, 2021, at Corona 2 p.m. Eastern Time. We have a lot to talk about today, including the potential for two or three more additional storms to be forming across the tropical Atlantic during the next several days. So let's go and jump straight into everything. Taking a wide look across the tropical Atlantic this afternoon, we continue to monitor the remnants here of what once was Hurricane Nicholas. This is now a post-tropical cyclone located over portions of northern Louisiana. And this will be scooting off towards the north and east during the next several days, and we'll be bringing with it the potential for some heavy rainfall and flooding concerns during the next several days as this journeys across that region. We also have Invest Area 96L right now, which is closer to becoming a tropical cyclone today, and Invest Area 95L, which could pose a threat to portions of the northern Antilles during the next several days, which we'll talk about here in a moment, and a new tropical wave that could go on to develop as this moves generally northwestward into the open tropical Atlantic. So you can see all this here in the graphical tropical weather outlook from the National Hurricane Center. Again, Invest Area 96L, 95L in this new tropical wave over here. In this tropical wave, not really expected to pose much of a concern to land. Either is 96L, but 95L does pose at least some concern over the next several days. So jumping from west to east here, we'll look here starting with Invest Area 96L. Now today we notice that there is more centralized convection, and we also notice that we do have more of an established circulation. We can kind of see some of the low-level cloud features down here are indicating that there is a circulation. If we actually look here at the zoomed in here, we can tell that the circulation or what is there is somewhat probably closed. Again, we have kind of this flow wrapping around on all sides at this point, and this seems to indicate that there is at least some sort of closed low-level circulation on the edge here of the convection. And we notice that it's on the edge, and that is in part because we have some pretty strong upper-level wind. That is in thanks because of a trough that is here. We also notice that, again, there's this trough here and an associated front with it. And we notice that most of the cloud elements are getting strong out towards the north. And there is some diffluent flow aloft here, which is helping to create this convection at the surface. And because you have diffluent flow aloft, divergence aloft, and then convergence at the surface, and you have all that air coming in, you have rising air at the surface, sinking air, you know, above, and this creates, again, that kind of vacuum. So we are getting a little bit of better convection and organizational structure today. And in fact, the Hurricane Center has now upped development chances of this to an 80% during the next several days or so. Now, one of the main things that is going to be going for the storm is, or going against the storm rather, is that this will be moving into a pocket of increasing vertical shear and also cooler sea surface temperatures during the next several days. If we take a look here at the 850 millibar vorticity, this is the spin in the atmosphere about 5,000 feet off the ground. We notice that here's our storm right now today. This is 96L, and again, mainly going to be following towards the north and east like such. Again, this kind of breaks down this ridge here because we get a trough. And if we actually look here and we go up to the 500 millibar height anomalies, what we can see is that we get this trough up towards the north here over Greenland, which actually weakens this ridge, and we get a stronger storm here. This is at 500 millibars, so this is a reflection of a storm all the way up here in the mid and upper levels of the atmosphere. And we can kind of see that we have this very kind of progressive flow where we have a ridge over Canada and a ridge over the far North Atlantic, but this natural weakness right here in the ridge. So a storm tends to follow kind of more towards the north and east like such. And we can tell that that's kind of the case, but the only problem is we see how strong this gets here within the next 84 hours. This is a very strong mid-latitude circulation during this time. And one of the main problems with this in terms of what's going to be happening here with 95L is that this is going to have a lot of steering differences for 95L, which we'll talk about here in a moment. So at least in the short term, we should get this jump that is likely out to sea here. So this shouldn't kind of come back, loop around, and hit land, but we will talk about some of the potentials here down the road. Now, looking and turning our attention towards a more interesting system, this is Invest Area 95L. And during the last several days, we've been thinking that development chances were going to get going as soon as now. But we haven't really seen that fester at all. In fact, we've seen very little development of the system during the last several days, and this continues to struggle producing any amount of sustained convection that's needed to really organize a surface center. Now, there is some circulation here, and indeed, an earlier ASCAP pass did show that there was a little semi-better defined circulation at the surface today, but this is just not enough, and this isn't going to cut it for being a tropical depression at this time. Now, by and large, what's going to be happening, if we jump to the water vapor imagery, we can already tell what's kind of setting up downstream here. We have, again, a fairly, or at least somewhat of a moist pocket around the storm right now. But the main problem with this is that there is also some mid-level dry air that we're just not picking up here. But we can kind of see the outline of this darker color here. This is indicating some pretty dry air aloft. And this is going to eventually, with time, try to work within the system here. And we're not getting much of an outflow production either. Now, we also notice that there's some pretty dry air over here, and this is a result, again, of the TUT, the Tropical Upper Tropospheric Trough. Now, if we jump back here to the 200 millibar wind here on the GFS, we notice that, again, our storm, 96L, or 95L, rather, is going to be running into this wall of shear during the next several days. And I can kind of see that it does kind of get pinched off. This is more of a classical TUT here. And there, here's Invest Area 96L. So 96L is actually sort of responsible for backing part of this TUT away, backing this upper level low away. But Invest Area 95L is going to be running directly underneath of this TUT. And the shear is going to be strongest and more maximized here on the southern side of it. And again, that entrance, as it kind of makes its entrance here, we can kind of see that there's still some semblance here. This TUT actually cuts off into an upper level low, and this upper level low is still creating a lot of shear out of the south, and we're actually getting a large amount of shear here. This is probably 20, 30 knots of vertical shear, and we're coming on the verge of where this would be too strong, in fact, for a storm to survive. And in fact, on the GFS, we don't really get a storm that survives. We have a very hostile wind environment. And this is only amplified by another approaching trough that's moving eastward with time. So a very unfavorable upper level environment as this thing gets, you know, even in the vicinity of the Turks and Caicos and Bahamas within just about, 5 or 6 days or so. Now, there is some complexity to this forecast. If we take a look here at the European and we jump up to the 500 millibar height anomalies on the Euro, we notice that, again, instead here of a storm that is getting carried more out to sea like on the GFS, we actually get ridging that blocks Invest Area 96L right here. This is actually a very typical blocking pattern. And just downstream of this ridge, we also have another trough developing right here. And this is also moving east. So we're going to enter a very complex pattern. Now, this in and itself would favor a storm that could turn more out to sea like this. Again, this is a massive ridge, and a storm just can't move into this ridge here. But this does signify that if we had a potential storm, what we can actually end up seeing is that this trough here is actually now beginning to erode the ridge to the north, and 96L is still hanging around. This is actually a reflection of 95L to the north of the Turks and Caicos, and this begins to move northward and kind of interacting, creating a binary interaction with 96L. We can actually see that on the Euro, we get a storm that moves awfully close to Bermuda instead of where on the GFS it gets more towards Turks and Caicos in the Bahamas before turning northward. Either way, solution of turning northward seems a little bit more likely now than a storm just going straight west into the Turks and Caicos and eventually the Florida Straits and the Florida Peninsula. Another way we can kind of take a look at this is on the HWAR forecast. Again, this is the infrared satellite simulation. We get a strengthening storm here within the next 48 hours. This is the HWAR forecast for 2 a.m. on Sunday, and this depicts here a strengthening storm with a pretty healthy central dense overcast at this point. But what we notice is eventually what ends up happening is we get a storm that succumbs to weakening, and eventually this thing wants to try to take off again. But we notice that, again, we get a storm that's generally heading where? Towards the north and west. And we can actually look at that here on the 10-meter wind field. Again, this is a storm that generally wants to head more towards the north and west during this time. And if we take a look at the steering over top of the storm, what we actually notice is that we get a steering that is generally out of the north here. And again, this would promote something that's heading more northerly than it would be a threat to the Lesser Antilles or the Bahamas or Florida. Now, like we said on the GFS forecast, this does actually make it into the Turks and Caicos as just a weak remnant wave and never really becomes anything until a mid-latitude cyclone picks it up and we get mid-latitude energy over the far North Atlantic. And again, this is really far out in time, so, you know, there's still a lot of questions. There's more questions still than we have answers at the point. And again, nothing is necessarily 100% guaranteed, but I'm not significantly concerned that we're going to have a substantial impact to the United States or, you know, the Bahamas or the Lesser Antilles or the Greater Antilles during the next several days. I'm just not overly concerned about it just yet. Again, you know, I really want to see how this pattern evolves. I'm sure that we'll probably have some upper level recon data, assuming a storm forms. It does look probable that a storm would form, but again, that delayed genesis is really just kind of interesting. But it looks like whatever probably develops will be moving northward and away and not really kind of creating much of an issue, as we'll get a series of fronts that kind of come down and scoop this thing up. So we'll see how this all evolves. But by and large, I'm not really concerned about it, nor should you. But stay tuned to your local media and Weather Service office. And of course, you know, stay tuned to me here. We'll be breaking this down every single day as we go forth in time. All right. With that being said, I hope you have a great rest of your afternoon and evening. Of course, I am Michael O'Malley. I'll talk to you guys again some more tomorrow.